bank in Indonesia and having a reasonably successful international banking career. On one of those days, our family went out to watch a movie called Three Idiots. It's a Hindi movie. And there's a dialogue in that movie where my daughter burst into laughter. And the dialogue was in Hindi, but I'll translate it in English for you. It basically said, if he's not an ass, what is he? He went and studied engineering, and then he goes and does an MBA, and then wants to become a banker. That sort of described me, if you like. That's a picture of my daughter. As you can see, she looks at things from a very different angle. I think that scene from Three Idiots had a role to play in accelerating my desire to switch to the social sector. It took me another year to quit the corporate career, come back to India, and join the social sector. I was fortunate to join Azim Premji Foundation, where I got to work across the length and breadth of the country, from offices in Lutyens, Delhi, to the tribal hamlets of Chhattisgarh. During this time, I also got to see many development sector organizations working on numerous causes across the country. The work that they do, the work that I saw them do, was truly humbling, making a huge difference to millions of people's lives. I wouldn't be exaggerating if I were to say that it's thanks to the work of these numerous development sector organizations working in cities, working in villages, because of whom a country as big, vast, and complex as India has remained a vibrant democracy with progressive ideas like fundamental rights, right to information, right to education, and affirmative action. Do you know how many NGOs are there in India? Any guesses? There are 3.1 million NGOs in our country. That roughly works out to about one NGO for every 400 citizens in this country. Even if a fraction of these NGOs are honest and relevant, it is still a very large number. With economic progress, a lot more money has come into the sector. The sector in India probably has a budget of about 50,000 crores. And you can add another 2 lakh crores, which the government spends on large development programs. Social sector organizations are becoming bigger, with philanthropists like Mr. Azim Premji leading the way. There's a lot more philanthropic money coming in to the development sector. Monies from abroad have come down a little bit, but the monies from CSR, corporate social responsibility, has significantly gone up in the last few years. This also means a lot of corporates are very involved in the development sector work in our country these days. While all this data is from India, the story is the same across the world. While development sector organizations have played a very big role in the progress of our society and the sector has been growing, there is a big problem they suffer from. The development sector organizations have a problem. And the problem is there's an acute shortage of good leadership and management talent in this sector. We went and spoke to lots of people across the sector to try and understand this problem of leadership. Because if leadership is a problem, it manifests in many ways. It manifests in great ideas not getting implemented well. It manifests in great work not being spreading out to more people who need that help. Or NGOs just struggling to find good people to take on senior jobs in their organizations. There are even times when I've heard funders say that I have money to give, but I'm not able to find an NGO whose leadership I can trust and I can give that money to, and so on. So clearly, if this is a systemic issue, this whole leadership crisis is a systemic issue, and if you're able to do something about it, it'll make a great impact. So a few years ago, a few of us went to try and study this problem. So we went and met lots of people across the country. We must have met in excess of, 700 people who are well-regarded practitioners. And we learned a lot from these discussions. But there were three things that really stood out for us, and it came repeatedly from different sections of the society. One, the sector has very good technical manpower who understand societies, people who know development issues, people who know how to work with individuals in less privileged sections. Two, the sector does have a serious shortage of leadership and management talent, and there's a need for managers and leaders in the sector who understand development and who understand management. And three, business management ideas are often misplaced in the social sector. So these discussions confirm that if we can address the leadership crisis in the development sector, it'll make a huge difference. And two, this point about business management ideas don't always work in the social sector is something that resonated with a lot of us, people like us who had worked in the corporate sector and in the development sector. What we found while talking to people is that, if you think about it, business management originated with the Industrial Revolution and capitalism. And the ideas like efficiency, productivity, production lines, etc., came from those days. And these ideas, while they work very well, and Industrial Revolution and capitalism has created probably the biggest prosperity and wealth that mankind has ever seen, it has also created the highest levels of inequality. And this is something that makes us feel that some of these ideas, while they work in business, don't always work in the development sector. A stark example of trying to apply industrial models in a development sector is the way our schools are run, something all of us are familiar with. Sadly, today our schools have become like production lines in a factory. Children are put on the first table and move to the second grade and the third grade. And along the way, if some of them don't meet the quality check, they're rejected and taken out of the production line. And that's just not the way a school should be run, but it is run based on Industrial Revolution ideas. Clearly, the reality on the ground is that we cannot use some of these management ideas in the development sector. If you take, even some of the more recent ideas of management, like, return on investments or maximizing shareholder value or human resource management or marketing and communication, you'll realize that as you go into the development sector, it's very different in the way things work and how you can apply some of these business management ideas. So, for example, if you look at the motivation for somebody to join an NGO versus join a bank, they're very different motivations. The reason they stay are different. The reasons that they leave are very different. If you take, organization culture, the kind of culture that will motivate people, that will inspire youngsters to work, are very different in a corporate world and in the NGO world. Most of you, I would imagine, for example, wouldn't mind investing monies, in a company whose CEO is flying around in a private jet so that he can be very efficient. But if I told you to put money into an NGO where there is a CEO who flies around in a business jet because he takes care of millions of children who are being abused, it's unlikely that you will put your money there. So what this says is that, you can take examples in finance. Return on investments. How does a finance management is not able to answer a question like, how will improving gender equality benefit society? How do you put a value to that? Management finance cannot answer questions like that. So if you take, human resources, you take organization dynamic, you take marketing, they're all very different when it comes to the social sector. So the development management is, the sector is really something that needs a different type of management. So question is, what type of management is required for this development sector, right? The approach to development management has to be very different. If you spend time with people in the sector, if you talk to, people in the sector and spend time understanding that, you'll hear many things which are very obvious to the people working in the development sector. But people like us who come with a business mindset, it is just not intuitive to us. And I'll give you some examples of that. The idea, for example, that there's no such thing as poor people. There are no poor people. There's poverty. That's a concept which is very difficult for a business mindset to accept. But once you understand that there are no poor people and there's poverty, then how you will go about addressing poverty will significantly change. And you can take similarly several other areas. If you take, for example, affirmative action or reservations, it's not just about economic equality. It's also about driving serious sociological changes. You can take livelihood issues. Livelihood issues is not just about creating income. It's also about addressing some serious societal issues in our society. If you take education, people think education is just about having good teachers and good schools. It's far more than that. There are issues related to values, beliefs, nutrition, sanitation, gender, language. There are so many issues you need to think about. The business mindset tends to think about things fairly in a causal manner. Even a straightforward issue like addressing the issue of open defecation is not just about building toilets. It's not even about building functional toilets. It's much more than that. Let me share a small story about a company that was doing CSR work in a certain panchayat. And that was a place where there were no toilets and the women were defecating in the outside. So this company decided to build a lot of functional toilets for the women in those villages in that sector, in that panchayat. And after some time, they came back there and they found that none of those toilets were being used. Those toilets were being used for everything else, ranging from storing things to all sorts of other things. And they just couldn't understand. And they were frustrated with that community, with the women of that community, and then they gave up. And they decided to take their money away to some other panchayat and to put it into some other area. Now, what the corporate had not realized, and no one will tell them this, is that in the society, which was a very male-dominated society, going out to defecate was the only outing that women had in that day. That was the time they got to meet their friends and sisters and, you know, talked about their problems at home. They even would, you know, lend and borrow a little money. So that was their life. So if you don't understand that and you assume that open defecation can be solved by building toilets, it's not going to happen. In the sector, we call the problem as wicked problems. When you're trying to work on a problem, the problem defines itself again. It changes. So it's a wicked problem. And you have to be able to work with those kind of changes. So management in the development sector also cannot be deterministic, if you know what I mean. As you can see from all these examples, development management work is non-linear, is complex, and requires an ability to engage and reflect and understand the deep and diverse forces that operate in society. What are the qualities of a good development management professional? A development management professional will require a range of qualities. She must have qualities related to the head, the heart, and the hand. Firstly, yes, it is important to have a cognitive understanding of this new domain that we are now calling development management. Secondly, one has to feel very strongly about the issues one is working on. I can work in banking for 25 years and not feel passionate about it, but you can't work on saving abused children unless you feel strongly for it day in and day out. And thirdly, one has to have the outlook and ability to understand the context and its relevance. And this requires the ability to look at issues from different societal lenses and from different perspectives of different sections of the society. So how do we produce high quality development managers? We need to find an answer for that. If you look back, when our country wanted good engineers, what did we do? We went and built IITs, right? We created IITs that produced some of the best engineers that the country has seen, or even the world has seen. When we needed management talent, what did we do? We went and built IIMs, and we produced some of the best managers. I understand that 50% of the CEOs of listed companies in the country today come from the first three IIMs. That's a group of my friends who are all CEOs or directors of companies. So yes, if you want to address development management, you need to build world-class institutions of development management in the country. What do we need to do? What do these great institutions have to do? Because the development sector is a little more complex than engineering or management. This will lead us to bring the best individuals and organizations of development management together. We need to build a body of knowledge for development management and establish it as a credible domain. We have to attract bright youngsters to join this sector. We want bright youngsters to come and address problems of society. We need to invigorate organizations in the development sector to believe in development management and to accept development management and to hire professionals in development management. So where do we start? I mean, this is all great stuff, but we need to start somewhere. And you know, where do we start? The place to start really is we must put the spotlights onto development management. What do I mean by we must put spotlights on development management? Well, we must take development management out of business schools for a start. We cannot allow development management to become this poor cousin of management. And I explained to you all the reasons why development management needs to be a standalone space. We must establish the profession of development management. And to establish a profession of development management which is aspirational, we need it to have its body of knowledge. We needed to have its norms, values. We needed to have its code of ethics, a network of professionals and professional qualifications. Ladies and gentlemen, leadership is important in most areas, but it's even more important in the development space than anywhere else. And that's because the development space involves dealing with thinking, feeling human beings. And development sector organizations exist to change the status quo. So you need a leadership quality that can change the status quo. In the coming decades, if we succeed in building great institutions of development management across the world and catalyze the creation and acceptance of development management as a critical and aspirational profession, I believe it will be the biggest game changer in the development sector. And this will make a difference to lives of billions of people that this sector is working with. I should end going back to where I started. And if you're able to do all this and, you know, in time, this idea of developing a new discipline and profession of development management is what we would imagine it to be, I believe it might inspire another Hindi movie, which could be called Four Idiots and Social Change. Thank you.